And as we begin our study of God's Word once again, and as we study the Bible today, we come to that section called the Feeding of the 5,000. Now, as we continue in our studies of Matthew's Gospel, I think this is a wonderful text because there's so many lessons to learn from it, and I only can give you a few, and I know that the Spirit of God can give you many more personally as you hear the Word and you study it. And it comes alive to each and every one of us. That's the greatness of the Word of God, because this book is not like some novel that we could buy in a store or anything like that. That's just dead words, and as much as it can titillate our mind and our thoughts about life and the world we live in, this teaches us not only about this world we live in, but in eternity to come and heaven itself. And so we look forward to that. Now, the lessons taught today, of course, are going to be about that day of miracle when Jesus actually fed 5,000 men, and even more than that, as we'll talk about in a minute. Now, it's interesting too, when I look in the Gospels, not all the Gospel commentators, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, necessarily tell everything that went on. So if you want to know everything that went on during the Gospel period, you really have to put the Gospels together in a synoptic way and learn the fullness of it. But this incident, the feeding of 5,000, was put in every one of the Gospels. So it must have had a great impact on the missions of the disciples on that particular day. But let's enter into this story of Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. You can follow along in your Bible or on your outline sheet, and we'll watch the visual Bible as it is dramatized for us, and then we'll get right into our text. So here we go.
Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said,
"This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food."
Jesus replied,
"They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat."
"We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish.
They answered.
"Bring them here to me,"
he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples. The disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children.
Father, indeed, it's a dramatic text, and much of what Matthew spoke about is condensed a bit, but we'll learn a lot more when we look into John's Gospel and Luke's Gospel and Mark's Gospel as well. And I just pray that each and every one of us here might take away from this study of the feeding of the 5,000, which indeed was a true miracle of creation, a miracle that only you could accomplish and do in spite of the detractors who would make fun of this passage of Scripture and say there was no miracle at all. But we know, Father, that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, the Messiah that was promised of old, and the one who came, who gave his life as a ransom for many. And we pray that everyone under the sound of the word today, those in our assembly here, and also those who will be listening on the internet or by recording, if anyone doesn't know Christ as their Savior, help them to see through this mighty miracle that this miracle-working God wants to save them from their sins. Now, Lord, I pray that they will look up into the face of heaven and see Jesus clearly and claim him and call upon him as their Messiah and the one who cleanses all sin to receive that forgiveness. Now, we who know Jesus as our Savior, we've received that forgiveness of sin. But nonetheless, we want to learn about this Savior of men and know more fully of how he can work in our lives and our hearts in the days ahead. So teach us fully from the word, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're coming to this section, and today I've entitled it Feeding of the 5,000. What other title could you give it that is as perfect as that, that truly tells of this magnificent event that was in these 13 through 21 verses in chapter 14. Now, if you have your outline sheet, we're going to look at three things: a monumental problem, a miraculous provision, and then the third one there, some marvelous principles. And I left some blanks in there that you can write it in, as well as the application inside as we move through it. So let's take a look and begin. Now, normally we'll begin with the first verses, but I'd really like to begin with a story from missionary history. And this is written down about one of the great missionaries who went to China. His name was James Hudson Taylor. How many have heard about him? I think everyone's heard about this man. Now, the story is told of this great missionary who began his journey to China. He was 21 years old. He left on September of 1863 from Liverpool, England, and began in a three-mast schooner to travel to China. Now, the story is told that along the way, they passed islands that were known to be filled with cannibals. And at this particular time, the ship sighted such an island, and on the shore there were natives holding their spears looking at the ship, and because something happened to the ship, the wind completely stopped. There was a dead calm. And we all know with a sailing ship and no motor of any sort, that it's going to move wherever the tide goes. Well, the tide was coming in, so the ship was drifting to the shores where perhaps these hungry cannibals were waiting for their next meal from the ship that was coming their way. Well, the captain was very concerned about this, and the story says that he didn't know what to do, but he remembered there was a missionary on board, so he went below and called on this missionary, Hudson Taylor, and asked him if he would pray for God's help to send a wind so they could sail away before the ship was aground on the beach of the shore. Well, Hudson Taylor said yes, he would be very happy to pray, but he said provided that the captain would set the sails for the winds. Well, the captain protested because he was not a man of prayer nor a man of God and thought it was completely foolish to do such a thing. And besides the fact, he felt he would look crazy to his crew to set the sails when it was a dead calm. But Taylor said, "I will not undertake for prayers unless you prepare the sails for answer." So encroaching peril got greater, and the captain buckled and went up and had the sails set. Well, Hudson Taylor was below, and he knelt down and he began praying for wind. Well, soon there was a knock on the door, and the captain was frantic. And he said, "Are you still praying for wind, Mr. Hudson, Mr. Taylor?" And Taylor said, "Yes," on his knees. And the captain cried out, "Please stop." He says the wind was so great, he felt that the ship would topple as a result of that. Now, that's the story. Whether it's true or whether it's a tale, I don't know. But one thing is sure, J. Hudson Taylor had many other stories to tell that were absolute truth of God's great deliverance and great power to this man who went to China and did a tremendous work. The whole gist of the story is really what's going to happen when we study the feeding of the 5,000, and that is, faith in God must be accompanied by action. Now just remember that, because for your life and mine, the same thing holds true. Faith in God must be accompanied by action. If you're going to pray for God to answer your prayer, then somehow you better act upon it before the answer comes, and that's important. So we'll see this miracle story of Matthew, and now let's get right to those verses of Scripture in chapter 14. Now when Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. And hearing this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. And when Jesus landed and saw the large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed the sick. Now, in order for us to have the fullness of the text, as I mentioned before, we're going to have to consult the Gospels, and we're going to do that as we move through that and learn the fullness of what happened on that day when Jesus fed the 5,000. But our story begins with Jesus, of course, last week, having heard of John the Baptist being beheaded and killed by Herod Antipas, who was now seeking for Jesus to come to see him. And that's the last thing Jesus was going to do. And so Jesus took off to a solitary place, and it says he withdrew by boat privately to that place. Unfortunately, that phrase in Matthew leads us to believe that the solitariness was that he didn't take his disciples along, but the other Gospels say he did. And as a result of that, we learn that they sailed from the eastern shore to the western shore. And of course here, this is north, somewhere in this direction here. And so this was the northern part of the lake. And Jesus and his disciples crossed the Sea of Galilee. Now the Sea of Galilee is a pretty large lake. It's 8 miles wide where Jesus crossed. And it's 14 miles north to south. And as they took to boats, and went across, we don't know whether they sailed across or they rowed across. There's a possibility that they rowed across. Maybe the winds there as well were not enough to run their sails. But if they rowed across, Jesus was going to a barren side of the lake and wanted to be alone with his disciples in a solitary place. Why did he want to do that? Well, I think there were three reasons. Number one was to mourn the death of John. It was a terrible thing, which he had heard, and the disciples as well. And number two, to find rest and comfort, because the scripture tells us that they needed rest. Jesus needed rest. The disciples needed rest. And it would be fine to do this in a barren place. But the third, of course, was where the disciples could be alone with Jesus without the crowds, and Jesus could instruct them, which he wanted to do before he went to Jerusalem. And Mark's gospel tells us a little bit about this. Notice what it says. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to his disciples, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and to get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. Now this fits with Matthew's text, which doesn't give us all the answers, as Mark gives us a little bit more. So after the stress of ministry in Capernaum, remember what happened in Nazareth, Jesus went there two times. The first time when his ministry began, and now as his ministry was moving to its completion, he went to Nazareth again, and in both times he was rejected by the people of his hometown, and they refused to receive him as Messiah. So Jesus decided best to teach and preach the word, but nonetheless, the nation of Israel was more and more moving to reject Jesus as their Savior. Now, as he went with his disciples to this secluded place, solitary place, it was a monumental problem. And that was because, as it said in the beginning here, there were so many people coming and going. They wanted to see Jesus not as Messiah, not to bow and receive him as their king, but they wanted to see his miracles performed. And some of them wanted to receive his miracles performed for their families and loved ones as well. So what did the crowds do? As the disciples began to cross the Sea of Galilee, they went around the northern end. Whether they walked or ran, we don't know, but they went around to the other side because they knew somewhere about where they were going to land. But now, as Jesus was with his disciples in the boat going across, and they were rowing across, I'm sure that they were not on any rush. They were not going anywhere. They were just going to the other side. So as they went across, I'm sure there were times when the rowing stopped and Jesus began to talk to them, because they asked Jesus questions and Jesus was answering. So perhaps this journey across was quite a long time to get across there. They left very early in the morning, and it was probably sometime around noon, maybe about 3 or 4 hours to cross the Sea of Galilee. But as they paused to hear Jesus, the crowds were running around from the other side to get there. And we're told in John's Gospel and others that it was not just a large crowd, it was a great crowd, meaning the tremendous thousands of people were in the process of coming across there. And hearing of the fact that they were crossing to the other side, they followed him on foot from the towns. And again, why? They all wanted to see and experience the miraculous healing ministry of Jesus. Some of them even brought their sick with them because they had heard that others had been healed in the process as well. Now, as far as the people were concerned, they didn't want Jesus and his disciples to have any rest. They wanted him to continue his ministry. And in a sense, I think any pastor knows that same experience. I had an opportunity once. I think I shared this with a congregation, but maybe not. I'll share it again. One time in my ministry at a church board meeting, one of the deacons got up and made a proposal for the board to vote on. And the proposal was, because I and my family were going to take a vacation in the next 4 weeks, they said they wanted the pastor's vacation canceled. And they wanted all the pastor's vacations canceled. And the reason why was twofold. Number one, every time the pastor went on vacation, so many people would disappear from the church, and the giving would go down. And so the church was harmed by the pastor taking a vacation. So if the pastor didn't take a vacation, the church would be okay. Second reason was, the pastor really didn't need a vacation, because all he did was preach on Sunday morning in their eyes, and he had a pretty easy job, Saturday night special message, and that took all things in. So that was the viewpoint of this one man. Lo and behold, when they took the vote, only 60% of all those there voted against him. Boy, I was glad at least that it was voted against them. But it gave me a viewpoint of how people thought about that. They felt that the pastor really didn't need a vacation. Well, Jesus and his disciples didn't need a vacation or even some secluded time alone away from the crowds. So they went and made sure that they would be there on the other side when he got there. And you know, Jesus could have very simply, when the crowds appeared and they docked their boat on the shore, he could have said, "Just a minute, I'm not going to minister anymore to you folks for a while. Why don't you go back home to your towns and where you came from? And when my disciples and I are through with some very quiet personal time, we'll come out and minister to you again." Could have said that, but he didn't. Because what happened? It says in verse 14, when Jesus landed and saw this huge, great and large crowd, what did he do? He had compassion on them and he healed their sick. The text actually says he healed all their sick. The needed rest and quietness that Jesus sought for himself and his disciples now would have to be delayed once again. And the text tells us that he and the disciples, the moment they got out of the boat, they had no time. Again, the people wanted to see him heal all the sick. And he did. He had compassion on them. Why is that? Well, Jesus looked deep into the souls of all these people. And what did he see? That they were sick physically and didn't have enough food or were lame or something like that? No, that's not what the Bible tells us. The compassion he had for them had nothing to do with their sickness, because we're told that the compassion he had to do with their lostness. Now, why was he concerned with their lostness? Well, here were God's own children, the elect Jews of the Old Testament. They were certainly religious people, right? Unfortunately, they had the one true faith that God had given to Israel, but they did not have it anymore because it was lost to them. For more than two centuries, the Pharisees and the Sadducees who taught them had turned away from the faith and formulated, we've learned this already, a false legalistic religion. What kind of religion? The Pharisees had reduced the faith to a list of do's and a list of don'ts, thus nullifying the true faith of the people. Judaism became apostate, and now it was only a small remnant of people who truly still believed the truth that God had given to Israel. The rest were in this fulfilling of do's and don'ts. You know, we have that today in the church. It's called legalism in the church. And wherever you see these lists of do's and don'ts that take over the churches, true faith is gone and lost to them. So generations pass. Now as a result, how did Jesus deal with these Pharisees and Sadducees? Well, he was not kind at all. Matthew 23:33 says, he called them snakes. He said, you brood of vipers. And he identified them. He said, how will you escape being condemned to hell? They were on the way to hell because they turned away from the true faith that was there. And they took so many with them. So when Jesus looked out on the multitudes, he had compassion on them. And again, why? Because of that very fact that they were lost. Again, you might say, where do you get that from, Pastor? Well, we get it from the Gospels and the other accounts that spoke about the feeding of the 5,000. Mark says, when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them. Why? Because they were sheep without a shepherd. Sheep without a shepherd. They were wandering on the hillsides, lost, and God wanted to restore them and bring them back to him. So whenever Jesus preached on the hillside to these people, he gave them the gospel. He showed them what they needed. He presented himself as the Savior of men. And if they would have received them, they would have been saved like we are from their sins. So in the process there, how did he do that? He began teaching them many things about himself. Many things about the promise of the Savior that would come one day and now had arrived on the scene. Now, seeing the huge crowds that gathered, his disciples began to worry. What were they worried about? That they were getting saved? What were they worried about? Well, take a look, and it says right there, hearing this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns, and when Jesus landed, he saw the crowds, he had compassion, he healed the sick. But, Luke tells us, late in the afternoon, the 12 came to him and said, remember, the 12 came, send the crowds away so that they can go to the surrounding villages and countryside and find food and lodging. Why? Because we're here in a remote place. A crisis was brewing. Many people, thousands, had no food and no place to go. And all they could do was maybe go to the villages because they were in a remote place. They might have been a mile or more away from a village, maybe miles for that purpose here. So they pleaded with Jesus, stop preaching, please, Jesus, so the people can go get some food. It's going to turn into something really bad. There might be rioting here for all we know, and we might become the victims. Who knows? You know how little they understood about Jesus, how little they understood about what he was doing this. Wasn't this the miracle-working God? Wasn't this the one who turned water into wine at the wedding of Cana? Wasn't this the man who healed all the sick? Isn't this the one who provided so many things? And now all they could think about was to send the crowds away. Matthew 14, 15 tells us about that. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place. It's already getting late." Now, getting late meant that it was probably about 3 p.m. in the afternoon. There were two evenings to the Jewish people, early evening and a late evening. The early evening began about 3 p.m. in the afternoon. And what was their response? Well, their response was like many believers today. When the going gets tough, get rid of it. That's the simplest thing. Jettison it from you so it doesn't bother you anymore and it's not hanging on you. Get rid of things. You know, churches do that. When the going gets tough, they get rid of the pastor. It's that simple, because then they don't have to pay a man anymore and they feel they can go on without one. And there's so many ways that this system goes on here. And so they cried and they cried. Now, how many people are out there? Well, if you go to verse 21, if you look on your sheet, it says there were 5,000 men. And it also says with women and children. And it doesn't mention also the sick and the lame who came as well. So you think about that. You add that up with the 5,000 men. How many people were out there? Well, it could have been upwards of 15,000. Some commentators say 25,000. I don't know, but I'll be conservative. 15,000 people were there. Can you imagine what this crowd, what would become of them if all of a sudden they had no food and no place and it was evening? There would have been stampeding. There would have been riots. But the disciples were rightly concerned about this very thing here. Now, of course, as a result of that, I'm sure that the disciples were getting hungry and antsy as well, and food was on their minds. But there was no McDonald's down the block or anything like that for them to go to. And the staggering numbers, they were really homeless people. They were famished wanderers, we could call that. And the crowds of famished, homeless, wandering people were there on the hillside with Jesus. You know, that reminded me, is that the only time in society where we see famished and wandering homeless people? Well, the answer is no. They're still with us to this particular day. You know, you look around our world today, and how many people suffer the same thing? It's amazing. There are more, this is the latest statistic, 795 million people around the world today do not have enough food to eat or complete the day. Would you believe that? Now, we don't worry about that. Our tummies get a little weak at noon hour, and the first place we think is, where can we go to eat? Maybe a restaurant, or maybe back home, or maybe to a friend's house, or someone like that. But there's always food for us to eat, and we don't think about that. But there are almost 800 million people that don't have enough food to eat. In addition to that, there's another 13 million people who are homeless in their lands. Why? Because of government takeovers, because of cultural genocide, and deadly famine that is around the world. And in Asia, there are 526 million people starving. Africa, 214 million, not to mention North Korea, Iraq, and Syria because of ISIS, all these things. And number three, every year worldwide, why? Every year, more than 16 million people simply die of not having anything more to eat as a result of that. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a terrible amount of people there. And when you think of the tens of millions of homeless people that are homeless because of maybe a natural disaster, tidal waves, earthquakes, fierce storms around, volcanoes and floods, killing more than 145,000 people annually. You know, you look at the perhaps one of the greatest earthquakes. It was a sea quake, if you remember, in 2004 in Indonesia there. In minutes, upwards of 300,000 people lost their lives from the tremendous tidal wave that took the entire area away. Here's a picture that shows the 2004 Indian earthquake coming on them. And look at these buildings right here. They are all going to be destroyed along the beach. So the problem is there. Millions of people will die because of illness, death, earthquakes, you name it, whatever it is. Why? Even in our own nation, what happened? You and I know about that. The here's a picture of the Hurricane Hermine that's right now, a couple of days ago, came across Florida there. You see it moving across Florida. And now, where's it going? It's going up the East Coast and right up here now. It's wreaking havoc up there. It's turning into a hurricane again. How about the Louisiana floods that left, I believe it is 20,000 people homeless as a result of that. Their homes were lost. And the hurricane says already they estimate 300,000 people will have damaged homes and lost power. So it doesn't matter if it's Jesus' day of homeless, hungry people. There's going to be people wherever we find them. But now getting back to the text there. Evening approached. The disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place. It's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the village and buy themselves food." They didn't want anything to do with them there. But as we look at this, the original reason the Lord and the disciples came there was for what? It was for a time of rest. They wanted to rest from their ministry, and so they were really tired. Jesus needed rest too. He was a human being 100%, and his body, mind needed rest as well. So the crowds, of course, they weren't concerned about rest for ministry. They wouldn't care if they fell over. They wanted them to perform for them and do that. And you know, that's the way it is in ministry in Jesus' day, and it's the same in ministry for anyone, even today. The crowds do not want rest. You know, I came across this. This is amazing. Some insurance companies today, if a pastor goes to buy insurance, life insurance for himself, do you know that because the longevity of life for someone who enters a full-time ministry is much shorter than for someone who is not in ministry, life insurance companies will rate you with an add-on premium for life insurance. It's amazing. The Fuller Institute of Church Growth took a survey some time ago and found something about those who are in ministry. And this is interesting. It found 90% work no less than 60 hours a week in the job. 80% believe pastoral ministry seriously affected their families quite negatively, and it did. 33% believe ministry was a real damaging hazard to their marriage and to their children. Divorce rates among pastors is growing, leaps and bounds. 75% reported a significant stress-related crisis appeared regularly in their ministries. Let me give you a whole bunch more statistics. Here's some more. 50% found themselves to be unable to meet the grueling daily demand of the people who called on them. 90% felt inadequately capable to cope with the severity of unending ministry demands. 70% said they had significant lower self-esteem now compared to when they started in ministry. 40% reported serious stressful conflicts with parishioners at least once a month. And just one more figure here. 70% said they do not have anyone they could consider a close friend or trustworthy ally. You know, there's no other job on earth that comes close to such stress level of spiritually, emotionally, and physically draining work that came upon the disciples and the ministry of the Lord that day. And the same for those who have followed in there. You know, I experienced that in my ministry, and at times it was ridiculous. One time at 3 p.m. in the morning, the phone rang. I answered it, figuring some terrible thing had happened. And a woman called and said, and she was a shift worker, so she was coming home from work, and she passed the church. She said, "Pastor, I want you to know someone left the light on in the church." 3 a.m. in the morning. You don't think that happens, but it does, from the variety of people that you minister to and things that are there. Now, if you don't think that's bad, let me give you some statistics here. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry every year? No. Every month because of burnout. 1,500 a month. I couldn't believe that, but these are the statistics that were given by the Fuller Institute of Church Growth. So, do you wonder why the disciples were worn out, or the Lord himself at that particular point here? So, what were they going to do with these 10 to 15,000 people gathered in this remote place who were simply depending on them to meet all their needs? Well, this brings us to the second thing in the miraculous provision. The disciples' answer, of course, was simplistic. Send them away! Get rid of them. We don't want to even deal with them. That seemed pretty callous, didn't it? Well, they realized it was a foolish statement, but nonetheless, think about this. If they sent these 15 to 25,000 people to the remote towns and villages who were around, let's say a village had about 200 or 300 people, what could they feed 15 to 20,000 people? 200 people. Remember, there was no refrigeration, so the only food they had was what they could gather or garner for the day, or a couple of days at that. Now, I thought about that, and I said, well, let's take this 10, 15, 20,000 people to 200, 300, 400 people in a village there, and let's take that statistic and put that ratio to Grand Junction. That would be equivalent to one evening, almost 2 million people would come into the area of the Grand Valley and demand food and lodging. Where would they get that? Where would they get that? It would be an impossible thing to do. And of course, we have refrigeration and different things that can have food there. So, how did the Lord react to this very thing? You know what he said in verse 15? Jesus replied, they don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. I mean, they were already frustrated, right? They were already pulling out the hair wondering what's going to happen. They're going to start rioting anytime soon here. And Jesus says to them, you give them something to eat? They must have just thought, how callous this was of the Lord to do that. And what was their response? Well, they went around, they looked around, and what did they find? They found 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish among all the people. Now, of course, we're told where that came from, and that came from a little boy. But nonetheless, let's take a look at the Gospel of John. Notice what it says here. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? He was concerned about it before he even healed anyone. Before he got out of the boat, he looked upon them and he knew there had to be food for them. He was thinking in advance, right? And Philip got out of the boat with him and he said to Philip there, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? He asked this only to test Philip, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. You see, nothing came on the Lord by mistake. Your great God in heaven, nothing catches him by mistake. No situation in your life ever comes to him by mysterious mistake. He knows about it in advance. He knows about what's going to happen to you 1 year from now if you're still alive. He knows what's going to happen to you 10 years from now if you're still alive. And he's already planned for it. Isn't that wonderful? Our God has planned for you and your needs before they ever began. So we don't have to fret about that. And so we're told by this very thing. Now, the Lord asked Philip because he wanted to test Philip to see how Philip would respond to this very thing. Now let's take a look at Mark's text. Notice what it says. They said to him that it would be more than half a year's wages to buy food for these people. Are we going to spend that much on bread to give them to eat? Now, half a year's wages. Now the Greek text speaks about the fact that there was only 200 denarii. And the silver denarii was a commonly used for 1 day's wage payment. So 200 denarii would give them 200 days worth of wages. What they were saying, you would take us 6 to 8 months of work that we could gather enough money to feed these people, and then they would only have a bite to eat. Now let's look at Matthew 14, verse 17. We have only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. And Mark says, that would take 8 months of a man's wages. Are we going to spend that much in bread and give them to eat? The disciples saw the impossibility of the situation. There was nothing humanly possible that they could do to provide. And they were distraught. They were confused. They were filled with fear. And they were fear that the people might even riot. But you know, God had allowed this crisis to come because Jesus didn't reveal anything till late in the afternoon, when it was really, in a sense, too late for them to even find food for them. And it was an unsolvable predicament to occur in that ministry. And let me tell you something. I had noticed in my ministry of over 40 years of full-time ministry that God often allowed things to go to the very extreme. And I knew it was to test the congregation to see how they'd respond. Whether they would go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to provide for whatever the particular need was or not. And you know, God will do that in your life. He's going to let you go out on a limb. You're going to go all the way out, and there's nowhere to go except to look up to God. And He's the one who can provide for you. So don't fret when these things come into your life, and they will come. Now, Philip, of course, he could think about this thing, and he's the one who came with the calculations of 8 months' wages for a man's wage to begin. So all throughout the Lord's ministry, part and parcel to it, Jesus was always ready to meet that need, but He wasn't necessarily going to show them how He was going to do it in advance. You know, that reminds me of others who ministered for people's needs. And one in particular, of course, was William Booth, who founded the Salvation Army. Think about that. In the beginning days of the Salvation Army, General William Booth gave people who were hungry something that none of the believers ever did before. He began to prepare hot meals for them, actual full meals, cooked meals for them. People in the church were critical of this, and they complained that the Christians' only duty was to win souls and to give the gospel, not to care for the perishing body. And William Booth used to answer, and he said this, and I quote, "How can you warm a man's heart to God when his feet are perishing with cold?" Good thing. Do you see what Jesus was teaching here? We better find ways to minister to man's whole needs. If you remember in the text before, what did Jesus do? He healed those, He had compassion on those who were lost, but He also taught them many things. So in other words, He was also going to provide food for them. But He wasn't only going to provide food. You know, the liberal gospel is simply go out and have a food ministry and feed the people of the world, the Mother Teresa's of the world. By the way, Mother Teresa was just crowned a saint in the Catholic Church. So now people can pray to Mother Teresa and she will answer their prayers. Isn't it sick and really idiotic? Well, she fed all the people, and she never gave the gospel to anyone because she wasn't concerned with that at all. It was just taking care of man's physical needs. But God says if you're a believer in Christ, it's not our job to just minister to the physical needs of people. You better also minister to the spiritual needs of people because they're lost. So, as believers in Christ, should we have ministries that have food kitchens? Yes, we should. Should we go out and have rescue missions? Yes, we should. Should we minister to the physical and emotional needs of people? Yes, we should. But don't you dare do it without giving the gospel. And to make sure that that is the primary purpose of that in the process. And so, of course, the Salvation Army founder was one like that. Now, this isn't a plea for you or me to open a soup kitchen, but nonetheless, we can do that as we preach the gospel and support ministries that do that very thing. Now this brings us to my third point, the response of the people. Look at verses 18 and 19. Bring them here to me, Jesus said. What was he asking for? these five loaves and two fishes that they had found among the people there. He said, bring them to me. And as he directed the people to sit down on the grass, all these tens of thousands of people there, he started to have the disciples organize them into groups of perhaps of 100 and to sit around in circles. Why did he do that? Because he was going to distribute food. How can you distribute food to 10,000 people who are standing together? You had to have them in groups so you could walk around and go through the groups and minister to them. So he said then, take the five loaves and two fishes, and they gave them to Jesus, and he had them in the basket, and he looked up to heaven, and he gave thanks to the Father, and he asked the Father to produce a miracle. Remember, Jesus was the one who performed the miracles, but he only performed it with the permission of his Heavenly Father. And his Heavenly Father gave permission to him long in advance, and he gave thanks, and he broke the loaves, and he put them into the baskets of the disciples. Later on, we're told that the disciples had 12 baskets. What were these 12 baskets? It was their fishing baskets. Remember when they did the drag net with the fish on the sea and they pulled them all ashore? They took the good fish and they put them in the basket and they threw the old or bad fish away. So every fisherman had baskets. They had them on the boat with them. And so they each 12 filled them up with a little bit of broken bread and pieces of fish. But when they reached in and as they walked along, we don't know when the miracle occurred, but it probably occurred only while they were walking among the people. And as they reached into their individual baskets for the little pieces of bread, out came big cakes of bread and out came fish. Now, what kind of fish went in that basket? That little boy who had the five loaves and two fishes, well, his mama packed it for him. And it was not raw fish. No one eats raw fish except, I guess, sushi, a little bit of that stuff. You know? This was cooked fish. This was smoked fish. How many like smoked fish? Oh, isn't that great? Well, the Lord smoked it for him miraculously. So every piece of fish that came out was cooked and smoked fish. What a wonderful thing. This was a miracle of creation. The creation of the fish and the creation of the finished cooked fish and the bread that had been baked. And so through this 10, 15, 25,000 people there, the basket never ran empty. God was doing this miraculous work, and then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. Now, there's some important lessons to learn from this. Here's three of them at least. Number one, what are we to do? We're to start with what we have available. They had to go out and find what was available among the crowd, and it was the five loaves and two fishes. And they brought them to Jesus. Jesus was going to do his miracle, but he wasn't going to do it unless they came with what they have. Isn't that a good lesson for you and me? If you want God to work in your midst, if you want God to do something for you, if you want God to do something through this church, the first thing we must do is look among us what's available for God to work in our midst. And then number two, once we find that, then we have to offer that to the Lord for his work and then trust him to use it for his glory. And the third thing is, it's important, obey whatever command you're to do along the way as you reach out in his name. You know, when the wedding of Cana was there, and Jesus was going to perform turning the water into wine, Mary said to the attendants, do what he tells you to do. And that's what they did. And then the miracle occurred. So you and I are to do what God tells us to do. Where do we find out what God wants us to do? Right here in the book as we study it and we put it in our hearts. So the practical lesson is clear. When there's a need, give all that you have available to Jesus and let him do the rest. It's important. Matthew 14:20 tells us, they all ate and were what? Satisfied. The word means filled to overflowing. Bloated, if you want. They ate so much of that delicious smoked fish and that lovely bread that it never ran out for them. Can I have a second piece? Can I have a third piece? The disciples kept it coming out of the baskets for them. And when they all were filled to overflowing, they left and went back to their villages or towns or wherever they were going, and all over the countryside were pieces of broken bread and fish that was left over. Now, of course, when we think about that very thing there, we might say, well, how did this all happen? Well, the response was, the people saw what Jesus had done. They knew what he had done. And it was a miracle, miraculous sign that Jesus did. And they were so moved by it, we're going to find in the text of the gospel text, that they were going to take Jesus by force and make him their king. That was it. They didn't need any more. This man was going to be their king and provider. They would not have to plant grain. They wouldn't have to work anymore. He would just provide food for them all day long of their lives. They didn't care. That's what they wanted. They wanted his miracles to go on and on and on. But you know, I've read texts that are absolutely ridiculous. I've read texts that say, oh, there wasn't any miracle here. When the little boy brought out his food of the five loaves and two fishes, all the other people who had actually hidden their food in their sleeve of their garments here, they were convicted and they brought out their food and they all shared it with each other. Doesn't that sound wonderful? That's not what happened. That's nonsense. That's biblical gobbledygook and godless nonsense. It was a miracle of creation. And there's only one person who can do that, and that's the Creator God himself, which was in the person of Jesus Christ. So, here we have a miraculous provision arrives. The feeding of the 5,000 was a bona fide creation of miracle. And they outwardly came to the knowledge of who Jesus was. He indeed was the promised Messiah. But you know, knowing that he's the promised Messiah and accepting him and yielding yourself and bowing down to him is something entirely different. And that's what they refused to do. They were not looking for him. The outward crowd simply wanted to crown him as king. John says in 6:14, after the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, surely this is the prophet who has come into the world. It's fine. But did they accept this one as the prophet and as their king? And the answer is no. John 6:15 says, Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. They outwardly wanted him to continue on with the ministry of miracle healing, and the feeding that they had seen there. You know, it was much like bread and circus. That's what they wanted, nothing more than that. You know, people still want that today in Christian circles. Except they don't want bread and circus. You know what they changed that to? Think about this. They want the rock concert and the food pantry. Those two things. Provide for us physically and our needs and give us entertainment and we'll be happy. Now, there's nothing wrong with singing songs of praise and glory, but it's not entertainment. It's praise to the Lord. And so we see this very thing. This brings us to the last thing, and you can write down the answers that I've given you some blank spaces here. Let's look at some practical principles that we can learn from the miracle. Before Jesus met the need of the multitudes, he chose for his disciples to first take inventory and scrutinize it. That's really important. Sometimes we expect God to work when we have no plan. We expect God to work because we have expended no effort on behalf of the plan that we want. Or worse, you know, at times, sometimes we hoard things and we say, all right, God, I've got this now, but I'm not going to give this out. Why don't you give a little bit more? And once you give out, then I'm going to do that. I was in a church one time where the leaders of the church hoarded money that came in and they hid it in a special account and never told the people about it. And they would not use it for anything in the needs. And they would go to the people and ask for more money. One day it got me so angry, I put on the bulletin board how much money was in the secret fund. And they got so mad at me, they never forgave me for that. And the people looked at it and said, we have that much money in the account? Yeah, we do. And let's praise God, and let's use it for the glory of God. So sometimes hoarding goes on as well. Now, in addition to that, remember Moses? And he had that staff in his hand. It was worthless and useless except when God turned it into a snake. Every Christian in every church, what do we need to do if you want God to work? Take inventory of what we have and then use it for the glory of God. Now, what do I mean by that? Take inventory of the talents we have. Take inventory of the resources, the possessions, the spiritual gifts. What do you have that God can use together with God's people for the advancement of the glory of God? We're going to give that special gift to that missionary. That's one thing to do. How wonderful it is. But let's continue to think of things we can do. We have that jar back there that is almost getting full of all the excess change we have. Are you still putting change in there? I hope so. You know, when that's full, there's going to be a lot of money in there when it's converted. And we're going to give that to a missionary as well for some prayer requests that they have. Take inventory and scrutinize it. Disciples did. Number two, be concerned with orderliness and ecology. The disciples picked the 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. You know, Jesus was teaching that he does things systematically and orderly and planned ways, carefully giving wisdom to it. And you know, the Bible talks about that. 1 Corinthians 14:33. God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as it is in all congregations of the saints. And everything should be done fittingly in an orderly way. And God wants to see that in your life. That means even you yourself, your own demeanor and your personality. You know, we're living in a society and generation today that is filled with slovenliness. You know why slovenliness is important? Because it's a rejection of God's order and a rejection of God's plan of orderly doing things. So begin with yourself there and ask yourself, are you neat? Are you orderly? Are you clean? Is your home in order? This is important because it is to God. So take a look at yourself. Are you messy and disorganized? That certainly isn't there. And as a result of that here, the disciples picking up these 12 baskets of broken pieces that were left over, Jesus said to them in John 6:12, don't leave anything. Gather all the pieces that are left over and let nothing be wasted. The greatest integrity in ministry is the proper handling of finances to avoid waste, but also avoid being cheap and stingy as well. You know, sometimes people in the church say, let's buy the least expensive thing for the Lord Jesus Christ. No, that's not the answer. We're to buy the best that is needed for the least that we have to pay for. That's being a good steward there. So many churches operate in what I call a crisis ministry. We wait for things to be broken. We wait for things to run out. No, we need planning. And a charge there for anything that requires maintenance. If you're in charge of replacement, make sure you have something before it runs out. You know that bulb and that projector is going to go. I want to ask you, do you have a spare bulb ready for it? If not, go buy a spare bulb, because that projector lens bulb is going to go out, and you may not find it anywhere for maybe weeks or months for that matter. So, just using a little thing there. Point being here, they all ate and were satisfied, and Jesus said, let nothing be wasted. How important it is. Now I want to give you, time's gone, I'm all gone. Let's go through this quickly. Application time, but go ahead. Four things. God stands ready to do mighty things in our midst and through us if we cooperate. Why is it on the screen? Here it is. To cooperate and begin giving him all we have. Now, by giving him all he has does not mean turn over all your assets to the church. That's cults. God says, whatever you have, make it available to the Lord if he calls upon you to do it. But make sure it's available. Number two, if we walk with Jesus and fellowship with him, you know what? There will never be a legitimate need unmet. There will not flow liberally unto all of us if we're ready to serve God with it. Number three, allow God to interpret your plans at times to minister on his behalf to others. Jesus did that, so should we. The disciples didn't know. They asked Jesus, and they had to wait for his answer. And number four, be sure you haven't missed the greatest miracle God has for you. He offers to save your soul. Jesus looked on those people as lost, and he preached the gospel to them. And I believe that there was a remnant that came to be saved out of that group. We know that as a result. And they, of course, followed Jesus closely as a result of that. And I'm thankful there's a remnant right here in this church. You and I are that remnant that were saved out of the multitudes of people. Isn't it wonderful that God saw you and called you to himself? I'll never stop praising him for that. I know you won't either. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for the word of God. I know we've gone over here, but it was important. There were so many things to see and know. That you are a God who liberally gives to overflowing, and a God who answers prayers and meets all needs. I'm thankful, Father, for saving me and my brothers and sisters, and I pray that we can be miracle people living for Jesus Christ, and that our lives will be in order for the world to see what you can do through those who are lost and are saved through Jesus Christ. If there's anyone here today who doesn't know Jesus Christ listening on the internet, I pray, Father, that you will open your heart to see Jesus clearly, and for them to reach out by a prayer of faith and put their trust in Jesus Christ alone, and to know his death on the cross paid for their sins, which he offers to forgive them if they'll come to him today. These things we ask together in Jesus' name. Amen.